Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, thanks very much for the invitation to come and talk to you this evening. It's a pleasure to be here in such an impressive room. My only concern is that the screen is a little bit small. I hope you can read the screen in the back. If not, just come to the front and the side. There are some chairs left. I'm going to talk about sustainable land use strategies, but when I talk about sustainability, I talk mainly about sustainability with respect to biodiversity conservation. We all know that all is not well in the world. Environmental conditions are pretty bad, and biodiversity is at an all-time low in human history. And it has everything to do with the way we use our landscape. We have become incredibly efficient, and I should know because I come from a country where we are probably the most efficient of all the most efficient countries in producing food. So this is an example from an area in the Netherlands where we produce a lot of food, but you can also see that we are converting about 90-95% of all the solar energy into something that we use, leaving nothing for other species. And as a consequence, not many species can survive in such landscapes. It's not all bad. So these are statistics that the Dutch government use, and they are real. So on average, population size in the Netherlands of butterflies, dragonflies, mammals, reptiles, amphibians, breeding birds, and fungi have remained stable over a period between the late 1990s and 2012. But that's only half the story. So there are a few species that do really well in human-dominated landscapes, and they have actually increased in population size. And these are species such as geese, or red deer, or wild boar. And all the other species, and especially the species that have been suffering for a long time, they are continuing to decline. And one of the consequences is that everything becomes more of the same. You find the same species everywhere, and you find most of the species in just a few places. And this is not something that is unique to the Netherlands or even Northwestern Europe. This is happening all over the globe. And I'm going to show this with an example I also use with my students. Here we have four pictures of agricultural landscapes in different parts of the world. One is the Netherlands. The other is Spain, the other is the United States, and the fourth one is Argentina. And I want to do a pop quiz to see your knowledge of the world. So I want to see hands for the people who think that picture A is the Netherlands. I see one hand, I see two hands. Oh, there are more. Oh, good. Okay, picture B, who? Also not that many hands. Picture C? Okay, that's a fair number. And picture D? Not that many. The true answer is picture D. But it's pretty hard to tell, right? And this is something that happens within countries. More areas become the same because we organize them in the way that is useful to us. And of course, all people are the same, so we all like the same things. We want drained lands, we want productive fields, we want safe houses, etc. So if we want to do something about that, if we want to have productive lands and at the same time have biodiversity or preserve biodiversity, we have to first understand the solutions of biodiversity decline. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about that using one particular species group to illustrate this, and that is bees. So we all know honeybees, but in fact there are many more species of wild bees. And here are a couple of them, and they are absolutely fascinating creatures. They come in all colors and size, hairy, without hairs. They have beautiful names like blood bees, sweat bees, mining bees, leafcutter bees, and of course, bumblebees. In the Netherlands, where I come from, we have about 360 species. In Germany, you have 570 species, and in Europe as a whole, about 2,000 species occur. Bees are functionally important because they pollinate about 80% of all the plants and a significant proportion of our crops. And at the same time, they're not doing too well. So this is an example for the Netherlands, but I guess that in Germany the situation is not significantly different. Slightly over 50% of all the species are listed in the Red Book, indicating that they are threatened in their existence. And one example is the shrill carder bee on your right-hand side, beautiful species that used to be widespread in the Netherlands, but is now effectively extinct. And on the other hand, you have a couple of species that have actually increased. So that's the early mining bee on the left, and it's an important pollinator of apple and other fruit trees, and it's doing quite well. The decline of bees is caused by a range of different factors. So it's not just one factor. You often hear discussions about pesticides. That's one of the problems. But in addition to that, it's habitat destruction, it's pests and diseases, and it's lack of floral resources that these species use for food for themselves and for their offspring. And you can imagine that this is a problem when you look at this landscape where there are effectively no flowers. So I'm going to focus a little bit more on these floral resources, not so much because it's the most important thing, but it's because it's something that we can easily examine as scientists, and that's convenient. So a colleague of mine, Jeroen Scheper, did this study where he basically looked at the relationship between the decline of host plants of bees and the decline of the bees themselves. And this is easily said, but a bit more difficult to do because many of the bee species that we wanted to know the host plant species of have disappeared or occur only in a few places. And how can you examine host plant use for that? So we found a way around that, and that was we went to entomological collections and we sampled pollen on the bodies of specimens that were collected before 1950, so before the time that they declined. And what you see is there is a clear relationship between the trend in the host plants. So all the different dots represent different species with different host plants. When the host plant of a particular species or the spectrum of host plants of a particular species declined, then the bee itself declined. And when the host plants, like this shrill carder bee, and when the host plants increased, then the bee species increased itself as well. And you have to realize these are, the host plants we're talking about are not rare species, right? So the shrill carder bee, for example, likes Fabaceae and Lamiaceae. So for example, red clover is very important for this species. And it's still a very common plant species. But 100 years ago, it was much more important, much more widespread, because it was cultivated as fodder for horses. We found another thing that we didn't expect. And that was that especially large-bodied bees were declining. And small-bodied bees were actually doing fine. And this is some of these results as a scientist that you stumble over, but gets you thinking. So one of the things that we thought was, does this relationship mean that there was selection pressure over the past century on large-bodied bees, but not on small bees? And we decided to examine this, and with we, I mean the PhD student, Miguel Olinda, who came from Brazil and stayed with us for a year to examine this specifically. And what he found was that, yes, indeed, small-bodied bees, especially female bees, they stayed about the same size. They declined a tiny little bit. But the really big species, like the big bumblebee species, they declined by almost 8% over the course of slightly more than a century. Is this significant? Yes, it is significant. We compared this to the trend in Dutch males. We have excellent records for Dutch males, for the size of Dutch males, because when they enter into the military, all the males are measured in size, and we do that already for 150 years. So we have good records. And you have to realize that in the 1860s, 1870s, unlike now, the Dutch were actually some of the smallest people in Europe. This has changed, I know. So what happened with the males? They increased by about 10%. So that's not that much different from the 8%, right? So that sort of suggests that this 8% change over 100 years' time is really significant. We also know why the Dutch males increased in size, why all of the Dutch people increased in size, and that has to do with food. And this is illustrated by this painting by Van Gogh. It's called The Potato Eaters. And that was basically all people ate during wintertime in the countryside. You know, they were dirt poor, they had nothing, and as a consequence, they didn't grow very well. And this has changed, we know, because by now the big problem is that we eat too much food. So when food has to do something with the increase in body size of the male population, then probably food or lack of food has something to do with the decline in body size of bees. Okay, that was a small side issue. Let's get back on track. So if we know that decline of floral resources is one of the reasons that is driving bee decline, can we then get the bees back by introducing the flowers back into the countryside? And this is something that you see all over Europe these days in an attempt to fight biodiversity loss. You see these wildflower strips. Now, this is a very nice example that we established ourselves with the right mixtures. You also see more colorful mixtures that we call in the Netherlands carnival mixtures, because there are all kinds of exotics in them, and we frown upon them. Does this work? Yes, it works. So this is a study, again, by Jeroen Scheper, who examined in 3 years the effect of establishing wildflower strips. 2011 is baseline condition, so there were no wildflower strips yet. And then in fall 2011, we sowed these flowers. And then the next year, you see a significant increase in the number of bees in sites with wildflowers. So that's good news. But there's a catch. And the catch is that the response is mainly caused by two species. That's the red-tailed bumblebee and the buff-tailed bumblebee, as they are called in English. And these are simply the two most common bumblebee species all over northwestern Europe. So if you have a garden, even if you have a parking place with just a couple of weeds, those are the bees that you will find. And this is sort of, again, Jeroen is featuring prominently. This is sort of the general take-home message of all these studies that have been done, and there have been many studies done investigating the effects of these so-called agri-environment schemes, so paying farmers to conserve nature on their land, the effectiveness of these schemes on biodiversity and specifically on pollinators. So you see that they raise the number of pollinators to a certain extent. That's because the dots are in the positive side. But it's mainly a response caused by common species, the ones that are adapted to human landscapes, the ones that are able to maintain themselves. That begs the question why it is so difficult to bring back biodiversity on farmland. And we have some theories about that. In fact, the first theory we devised was already devised quite a long time ago. I did it together with Bill Sutherland. And we said, what if biodiversity doesn't decline linearly with land use intensity, but exponentially? Why is that important? Well, if you take conservation measures that reduce land use intensity and you do it at the extensive end of the range, so on the left-hand side, then the potential increase in biodiversity is quite high. But if you do exactly the same thing in the intensive end, then the potential increase is much lower. And of course, in the country where I am, where I come from, we're at the extreme right-hand side in the intensive end. So this could be an explanation. We sort of tested this recently, specifically for bees, a study led by Johan Ekroos of Lund University. And this graph shows a comparison of the total number of bee species on 50 grasslands, agricultural grasslands, that were either not fertilized on the left-hand side or pretty heavily fertilized on the right-hand side. And of course, what you find is that the total number of species encountered on the extensively managed grasslands is much higher. That is to be expected. But what is interesting is that almost 80% of the species that we found on the intensively managed sites were also found on the extensively managed sites. And this suggests that as you intensify, you will lose a large number of species, and some of the species persist, and some of them even become more dominant. Moreover, the rare species, or the species that we now call rare, that used to be quite common, they're all found on these extensively managed grasslands, virtually restricted to these grasslands. And then the shared species, so the dark gray part of the bars, those are the species that are functionally important to us, simply because they're so common, they're not picky about the flowers, and these are the species that pollinate our crops. But there's another reason why it is difficult to mitigate biodiversity loss on farmland, and that has to do with the people who are active on farmland, the farmers. Motivation. So, when we were studying the effectiveness of agri-environment schemes, we also went to the farmers and basically asked them, why do you participate in these agri-environment schemes? And the most common answer they gave was to supplement farm income. And it's an objective of these schemes, so it's allowed to answer this, to think this. The second reason was that because these fields with these agri-environment schemes, they were unsuitable for intensive farming anyway, either because they had higher water levels or because they were far away from the farm. So they wanted to get some money anyway for that. And then only the third reason was to contribute to nature conservation. So only half of the farmers answered that they were hoping to contribute to nature conservation for when they were asked why they were getting money to conserve nature on their land. And this is problematic because it affects the effectiveness of these measures. And this was illustrated, and this is a story I heard. I haven't been there myself, but I can fully imagine such a thing to happen. Situation when Romania entered the European Union. When they did that, they had to develop an agri-environmental program, basically offering farmers payments for conserving biodiversity on the land. But when Romania was entering the European Union, basically everything the farmers did was already good for biodiversity. They had a lot of biodiversity on their land. The management was really extensive. So farmers could ask for money basically for continuing to do what they did anyway. But now they were getting money for it. And the first thing they did with the money when they got it was buying fertilizers. And that's problem. That illustrates the problem that if you're not interested in biodiversity and you still participate in biodiversity conservation, then all the other things you do on your farm may counteract the effects of these activities targeting biodiversity. So what next? So far it's been pretty depressing. But we think there's a way out. And we think the big problem of the situation so far is that we have been considering sectors in isolation. So farming in this case. We're talking about offering farmers payment to invest in biodiversity conservation, for example, by establishing these wildflower strips, but we don't consider where they should be located in the landscape, how the effectiveness is affected by, for example, the location of protected areas, which can act as sources for populations. And this, of course, reduces the possibilities you have to conserve these species. So let's focus on this picture on the right-hand side, which is pretty much prime bee habitat in the Netherlands. Species-rich grasslands, these are Natura 2000 sites. And when you look at how they are located in the landscape, it looks like this. So this is an area in the extreme south of the Netherlands where we actually do have some hills. And you see that these protected areas, they are scattered over this landscape and they are pretty much isolated. And this is typical for the Netherlands and I think for many other countries in Northwestern Europe as well. They're small. This is a graph showing that actually 80% of all the protected areas in the Netherlands are smaller than 10 hectares in size. And most of the remaining ones are smaller than 100 hectares in size. And that means that they are very vulnerable to what's going on surrounding them. The rest of the landscape looks like this, and actually from an aesthetical perspective or structurally perspective, it looks okay. But if you're a bee, there's nothing there. This is just a green desert. So how can we connect these protected areas, or even better, how can we create a landscape that actually enhances bee populations as a whole? So this is a simplified version of this picture, with red the settlements and black the roads. And when you zoom in part of the landscape, basically what you can notice is that there are many different stakeholders at play in such a landscape. And one of them, for example, is a conservation organization, and they manage these parcels, highlighted in green. And of course, they, even if you want to, they cannot modify the management on all of these sites, but they have a couple of sites where you can choose from. And the same thing for farmers. So this is hypothetically the area managed by farmers. And then you have a municipality that manages roadside verges and ditch banks and stuff. By themselves, they can not have a strong impact on biodiversity. They'll always be impaired. But as a combination, you have a lot of choice and you can actually manage the landscape in a way that is suitable for the populations of the species that you want to enhance. So this is basically what we're trying now. So we're focusing on a couple of landscape elements or habitat types that are useful to bees. This is a project targeting bees. And where modifications, habitat management, is relatively easy. It's still costly, but it's manageable. So this is the reference habitat, the species-rich grasslands. And then we have grazed low-productive grasslands. They're also managed by nature conservation organizations, but they are of a lesser quality because of soil type, and therefore they are managed in a cost-effective way. So they're basically rented out to farmers and they graze the land year-round with the result that there are no flowers in these grasslands. We have water retention sites because it's a hilly area and they want to prevent the villages in the valley from flooding. They've created these water retention sites to do that. And they are suitable for bees as well. And then we have the obvious roadside verges, the field boundaries, and the hedges. And currently, they're all managed in a way that is suboptimal for bees. And this is illustrated here. Here we have species richness. These are basically baseline conditions that we, the data that we collected. And you see that species-rich grasslands by far support the highest number of bee species. And then we have the water retention sites and the pastures. They are sort of okay. And then much lower roadside verges, field boundaries, and the hedges are really at the bottom. And this is probably determined to a large extent by the number of flowering plant species in these habitats. Because you see that the pattern is exactly the same as the number of bee species. So this gives potential to increase the quality of these habitats by introducing management that increases flower numbers. For example, in pastures, by the flower richness is already pretty high, but these cover a large proportion of the area. So if you even if you increase flower richness by 5 or 10%, you have a significant impact. But also, for example, field boundaries, if you can introduce these wildflower strips along these field boundaries, you can have a significant impact. So this is what we're going to do. We collected baseline data in 2018 and 2019, and next year in 50 locations in this landscape that I showed you, we're actually going to introduce management to enhance wildflowers. And of course, we're not doing that by ourselves. We're doing that with all the organizations that manage the land. And there are a fair number of organizations. So the nature conservations alone are three separate organizations because we have sort of divided this over different organizations in the Netherlands. The province is involved, two different municipalities, a water board and a water drinking company. And there are also some individuals, Ivo Raamakers, the picture on the top. He's my partner in crime, and he is the guy that knows everything about the bees, everything about the area, and it's essential to have a person like that in your team to actually achieve it. And it's good to realize that when you start such an event or adventure, I should call it, you should sort of test the water with each stakeholder, what particular motivation drives him. With farmers, and this is just an example for the farmers, usually the first thing they think about, because they have to think about it, is money. What does it mean for my income, for how my company functions? And then maybe second, the functionally important species, like the natural enemies and the pollinators. And maybe only then you can talk about all the other fun and cool species that occur in the area. But if you talk to a nature conservation organization, you probably have to turn it around. You have to start with the charismatic species, the cool species, and then say, well, yeah, okay, you know, it's also good for ecosystem functioning. And okay, it also costs a little bit of money, but you can probably do it like this, you know? So, that brings me to the end. Restoration of biodiversity requires a landscape scale approach. Requires involvement of all stakeholders and should consider agronomic, economic, and social aspects. And it's probably one of the reasons, the complexity, why so few scientists have ever embarked on this adventure. But I think we're now at the stage where we really have to do it. We're going to do it in the Netherlands. So maybe in 5 years' time I can tell you about the outcome. But it's also part of this new societal movement in the Netherlands, the Delta Plan Biodiversity Recovery, which basically started after this study in Germany, informally known as the Hallmann paper, which showed a 76% biodiversity decline in biomass of flying insects in 27 years' time, which had not only an impact in Germany, but also in the Netherlands, made something loose in society, but also in politics. And one of the things was that unusual partners came together. So farming, banks, retail, environmental organizations, nature conservation organizations, and science, without the governments initially, and said, okay, we're going to change the whole thing. And we took 1.5 years to sort of make the outline of a plan, and we're now going to implement it. And it involves about this nature-inclusive landscape management. So not just talk about farming, or not just talk about nature, but the landscape as a whole. Very important in this is the development of earning models. So people who are working, helping us with this, should at very least be compensated for their cost, because otherwise nobody is going to do it. Nobody can do it. You know, they also have to make a living. Ideally, we want them to make money from protecting biodiversity, because then it really motivates people to become active in this. And by doing that, we hope to bend the curve. That's the objective. So going from a decline in biodiversity to an increase in biodiversity. And with that hopeful message, I would like to end, and thank you for your attention.